are back, and we are here with Lindsey Bomgren. Lindsey, how are you?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Oh, I was excited to talk to you for so many reasons. The first reason is, and I feel like everybody probably asks you this, you live in Minnesota.
That is correct.
They love talking to you about the weather.
Everybody loves the weather here.
Why? Why are we so infatuated? Like people, so I'm from New Jersey. We hate the cold, but we want to talk to people who have it worse. Oh, it's really cold there. Let's talk about that.
Right. I know. I think it's for Minnesotans. I think it's almost like a pride thing too. It's like we survive the coldest and the toughest of winters, and then we have the best summer. Like it's very prideful, you know. We survive the tough stuff, so we can really enjoy summers in Minnesota. Are pretty beautiful.
Really, they're that good.
I mean, I think so. I grew up, my parents have a place on the lake, which is, if you can enjoy a summer on the lake in Minnesota, I mean, I think it's pretty amazing.
Does it get really hot there? Like summer?
No, it's pretty, that's the thing is it's like, it doesn't get super hot. It's like the perfect amount of hot. I mean, I like it hot, but like you're talking like high 70s and 80s, the perfect amount of hot, but just, I mean, there's so many lakes here and the lakes are all beautiful. Like they're quality swimming, boating, and everyone is like in Minnesota because we only get like 3 months of the really good stuff. Everyone is outside those entire 3 months. Like companies offer like Fridays off. Like it's part of like when you sign up for a job, you're like, and what about summer? Like, do I get Fridays off? Do I have to work all the time?
Wow, that's amazing. Did you find that during quarantine, even in the coldest times, like people were trying to get out more?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely funny now because it's starting to get nice in spring and like all of our neighbors are coming out of the woodwork and it's like, oh, there you are again. But yeah, Minnesota's pretty active. So people still like, they put snow tires on their bikes. You just dress appropriately. You buy the expensive winter coat because you're going to use it.
Uh-huh. Do you kind of laugh at other places and their winters?
Yeah, you know, it's funny because I've had like Zoom calls with people all over the nation and stuff, and like in Texas when it snowed, and they were like, and I felt bad because they're just not equipped for it, right? Mm-hmm. But they're just like, oh, it's so cold here. And I'm like, I mean, we had a pretty mild winter, but yeah.
That's good. So the good thing is that most of your job entails that you stay inside. Because you do work out inside. But I was looking at your website and you have a lot of certifications. So why don't you go ahead and explain them all so I don't mess them up?
Yeah, you know, I didn't go to school for like kinesiology or anything like that, like most people do, but I actually got into sales. I have a marketing and communications background, but really I always had a passion for fitness. I was a college athlete, played volleyball in college, and got into the whole running thing. Actually, after college, I ran several marathons, and then I transitioned into the strength game, did some strength training competitions, like fitness competitions where you stand on stage in a bikini. That's like a whole back part of my life. But during that time, I just wanted for my own knowledge to train myself. And so I got my personal training certification and started training some friends kind of just on the side. And I found out personal training just like was not for me. I'm kind of a control freak. And I had a hard time with people coming to me and like, they're like not seeing results. I'm like, well, I see you once a week. I have no idea what you're doing these other 6 days and I can't control that. Mm-hmm. And so I found group fitness and that's really where I just like found my jam. Mm-hmm. I just loved being in that room full of people and energy and pushing people. So I went back. So I have my personal training certification, group fitness certifications. And then just along the way, you know, you have to do your CEUs, you just accumulate stuff, but I've kind of dabbled in everything, bar. And then I got pregnant, did my, you know, did pre and postnatal certifications as well as like prenatal yoga, all that stuff. So just kind of has evolved with my life as my life has gone through different seasons from running to strength training to postpartum and, you know, post and prenatal too.
Let's go back. How did you transition from, so you played volleyball in college, which is a team sport, but then you got into running, which is a solo kind of thing. What was it that attracted you about running?
Yeah. I mean, so basically what attracted me to it was I just needed a goal. So I graduated college and for the first time in my life, I wasn't forced to work out or I didn't have a team or anyone relying on me to work out. And I started working behind a desk for 8 hours a day, which was kind of depressing and just like all my fitness goals kind of fell off. And like, I wasn't super happy. I wasn't moving a lot. I was putting on weight and I was just like, okay, I need a goal. I'm a very goal-oriented person. Like, I can run. Let's go ahead. I'm going to run a marathon. It was just kind of like one of those big out there goals that I was like, I'm just going to do it. So, and I'd moved into the Minneapolis area kind of by myself. I didn't have a ton of friends in the area yet. So I just started running at night after work by myself, just go on long runs. And that's how I kind of got into running. And yeah, I don't know why. I just kind of picked it and chose it and went for it. And I always like to bite off more than I can chew, I guess.
How many marathons did you do?
So I've done so many halves and like all 5Ks, 10Ks, halves, but actual marathons, I've done 4.
Okay.
Here in the US. And then I actually 2 years ago, I went to Haiti and ran a marathon in Haiti, which actually was like more like trail running. It took us 9 hours to complete this marathon. It was like up mountains, but it was for a fundraiser to raise funds for healing waters, to bring clean water, to build a clean water solution for a community in Haiti.
How did you get involved in that?
So I actually, when I started my business, you know, when you start a business, it's so focused on you. And I thought that like I was going to just replace my income. And part of my business goals was always to give generously, like to organizations I believed in. And I finished like my first 2 years in business and I didn't have even like a penny to take home myself. I'm like, how am I supposed to give money to anybody when I can't even support myself? So basically I just decided to start this charity event called Fit for Her, where we, you know, I'm like, I'll teach a workout class. Everyone can come. Pay me for that. I can give like my service and then I'll just donate that money. And so I ended up choosing the Her Initiative, which brings water solutions to women specifically in communities, health and hygiene, in communities in need. And that's part of Healing Waters. So that's how I kind of teamed up with them. And we kept that going for like 4 years. And throughout that process, I went to several of their water sites, like in the Dominican. And then I had this opportunity. There's a guy named Bryce, blanking on his last name now, but he started a nonprofit called Run 50/50, where he ran 50 marathons in 50 different states to raise money for Healing Waters. And so he invited me to run a marathon with him in Haiti, and I just jumped on the opportunity and went.
Okay, let's talk about a lot of the times we think about things like this. So when you're going into a marathon for the first time, you think what a marathon's going to be like, and then when you're actually in it, it's way different. Now, what did you think running in Haiti was going to be like, and what was it actually like?
So total transparency. I had plans on being pregnant. I was like, I'm going to be pregnant. I'm not going to make the trip. He invited me and I was like, yeah, I'll go, but I'm going to get pregnant. So I'm going to end up dipping out. And I didn't get pregnant. So I was like, okay, I'm not pregnant. I don't have an excuse. I kind of have to go do this thing. So total transparency. I think I had logged max 10 miles before I went there. But I was pretty confident. I've done that before, a marathon before. I signed up for a marathon. My sales schedule got really busy. I was traveling all the time. I think I'd run like most 10 miles, but I'm really big into like strength training and high intensity interval training. So I'm not suggesting that you run a marathon and just train 10 miles, but I knew that I had the capacity to do it. Probably wasn't going to be the best idea for my body, but I knew I could do it. So I had only run like 10 miles before. So I was kind of going into it like, I mean, I'm just going to do my best here and kind of, and I was nervous because he's run 50 marathons. So I was like, this dude's like legit. But I mean, he kept like, he was running all these marathons. So he wasn't like sprinting them. He was keeping a sustainable pace. So,
the two of you?
So it was the two of us that ended up finishing. There was actually like 7 of us that started, but only two of us finished. It was a pretty rugged terrain. Like it took us 9 hours to run it. Mm-hmm. And like, yeah, it was pretty rugged and it was pretty uphill. Like, I mean, we were running through like rivers and then it started like downpouring rain. We were like landsliding down some of the, I mean, it was wild. We actually had 2 trucks tailgating us because it's kind of dangerous in Haiti. So we had 2 trucks like tailgating us and they couldn't make it, like lost 2 tires. The train was so bad. So like, I mean, it ended up being this wild experience. We ended up running like 5 miles in the wrong direction because we lost the trucks. Like it was a wild, wild experience, but definitely top 5 coolest things I've ever done in my life. Where we ran, they told us like legitimately probably only 100 people have even walked that path because it's just like so out there and kind of in the middle of nowhere.
Was that the last marathon you ran?
That's the last marathon I've run.
That's what I figured. Number one. Number two, did you blame your husband?
For
not getting you pregnant.
Oh, yeah. Right. No, because I was so happy I went. It was such a cool experience. Okay. It was a really cool experience.
Because I could totally see something, maybe not you, but I could totally see a woman going, this is your fault for not getting pregnant. And I'm sorry. I don't think those words have ever been uttered. This is your fault for not getting me pregnant. Now I have to run a marathon.
Right. I know. It was just like one of those things that it just, everything worked out the way it was supposed to. I'm so glad I did it, yeah. But I was really hesitant about it, but I'm so glad I did it.
That's one of those stories too, that you're not going to go to a party and someone else also has that story.
Right. I know. Right. Like it's a very unique story. And yeah. Though that whole Haiti experience was super unique, but it was super cool.
That's amazing. So I was, you know, messing around in your website, toying around, looking around at all your stuff. There's a lot on there and I love it. One thing that I loved the most, and I actually wrote it down because I want to say it correctly, and I want you to talk about it. It says, I don't film workout videos to give you six-pack abs or a nice butt. I film workout videos because I know fitness makes me a better wife, mother, friend, and human. I think a lot of people forget that. That should be the main reason that they're working out. So can you talk about that?
Yeah. You know, when I started in fitness, I mean, I've come a long way in my own fitness journey, right? I think everyone has, everyone has a quote unquote journey. But when I kind of went into this endeavor saying like, hey, I'm going to start a business and try and, I don't know, I was going to film these workout videos. I don't know if I thought I was going to be the next Tony Horton from P90X or what, but I was like, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to film these workouts and kind of start to build a business off this. And I thought that meant like I had to have this certain body type in order to get people to follow me and think about it. And then, you know, eventually like my life was going to change. I was going to get pregnant and my body was going to change. And I had to go through this, like, would people still trust me as a fitness trainer if I didn't have six pack abs in this specific body type? And I, through this whole process, I just learned myself like fitness. I never wanted to be one of those like sweaty selfie six pack abs, always sharing transformation pictures and all this stuff, because to me, it's just so much more than that. I mean, just like it says, like, fitness, I think, builds mental toughness, physical toughness. It just carries over, especially this past year, we've gone through COVID. I think fitness is such a big part of mental health for people that it allows, when I finish a tough workout, I feel like I can tackle anything that day. My son throws his plate on the ground. I'm like, that's cool. I'll take a breath. I'll squat down. I'll pick it up. I'm not going to lose my cool. Mom got her workout in this morning. She feels good. Like, I know it just genuinely makes me a better person. And I just want to share that with other people. Like, fitness does not have to be this like punishment or whatever. Like, I want people to use it as a tool to better themselves.
Before we talk about your videos and everything you do, I want to go back for a second, because you have the entrepreneurial spirit and you started this in 2015, but yeah. Saying in 2021 that you're going to leave your job and do videos online for people to work out to doesn't sound that crazy. In 2015 might have sounded a little bit nuts.
So yeah.
Walk us through how that happened.
Yeah. So I did sales, medical sales, actually, which is a great job, very lucrative. And, but I decided I was going to live off my kind of my base salary and I was going to save all my commission and put it aside because I knew I wanted to start my own business. And like I said, I don't know if I thought I was going to be the next Tony Horton, but I was like, I'm going to film workout DVDs. So actually when I quit, I filmed workout DVDs. So think back to when DVDs were a thing. So I wasn't initially even thinking like, I'm going to stream online workout videos. I was like, I'm going to film these DVD sets and I'm going to set up a website and people are going to buy these from me. And I'm glad I did it. I spent like my life savings doing it because it led me to meeting a lot of the right people I needed to meet along the way, but ultimately wasn't the best game plan. But then I realized in this whole online space, because in fitness, right, you're either like a personal trainer who has to work service hours and isn't making like the best income. Group fitness instructor, I can only teach so many classes a day physically. And so like, what are my options? And so I was like, how do I make this a sustainable living for myself and not burn myself out? And so it was going online. And so I was like, okay, digging into this. And I'm like, all these people are posting recipes for free and somehow making a living. So I like really dug into the food blogger space. And I was like, what are they doing and how are they monetizing it? And when I kind of started learning the tricks of the trade, I was like, I can do that for workout videos. So I didn't like go on like wanting to become like a YouTube star or anything like that. I actually just started using YouTube like way behind the times, kicking myself in the butt. Like this past year, we just started really capitalizing on YouTube. Previously, we were just capitalizing in the blog space, content space. So really trying to rank on Google, get eyeballs, monetize off ad revenue. So ad revenue is still my bread and butter, but it's all free content. So we put out free workout plans, free workout videos, and we monetize off ad revenue. So getting eyeballs to our site. So I'm competing against Women's Health Magazine, Shape Magazine, and all these other magazines or big editorial outlets that are posting the five best tricep exercises or bicep exercises or whatever that is. That's who I'm competing against to try and get eyeballs. And then I have my direct audience too, but yeah, that's kind of how it all started and has continued to evolve.
Here's one of the things I've noticed, because I do both. I'm not the fitness person like you are, but I do the online content thing and I've done,
yep.
It's very much like working out in this way. And you kind of touched on it a minute ago. When you're working out or like trying to get fit, you basically can't do everything. Like you're going to run, but you can't. If you're training for a marathon, you also can't lift heavy and do like CrossFit and you have to concentrate on one thing. So when you're doing stuff like this, You can't be like, okay, well, we're going to do this. Then we're plus going to do YouTube. Then we're going to be on Twitter. Then we're going to, you have to like find your wheelhouse, find the one thing you're at good at, and then everything else will kind of branch out into that. So I think it's good that you concentrated, like you started with the DVDs, they moved into, you figured it out through the food bloggers, and you were like, okay, I'm going to concentrate on the Instagram part of it. And then everything else will kind of branch out. And I think people can learn a lot from that, not only with building a brand online, but also with working out. Like you can't do everything. So do one totally. Thing you really love, get good at that, and then it kind of moves to everything else.
And I would say on top of that, when like people ask me, what's, you know, I want to start a business in the online space, what's your number one suggestion? And I think this, like I said, this applies to kind of all facets of life, specifically working out, consistency. Like you need to, there's so many days I don't want to show up and I don't want to post to Instagram, or I don't want to show my face, or I don't want to film, you know, whatever, like put up another blog post, put up another Pinterest post, but like it's consistently showing up every day, knowing when people know every Tuesday, every Thursday, I put out a workout. I'm going to land in your inbox every Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday with email newsletters, like consistently creating those rhythms and routines and just showing up and building and building and building.
Is the same mentality you use to tackle that part of it the same one you would use to, like, in other words, do you focus the same way you would on putting out content every day the way you would working out every day? Does that make sense? Like,
yeah.
You have to say to yourself, I always have to work out. You have to say to yourself, I always have to make content. Is that the same kind of part of the brain?
In a sense, like I'm a scheduler, I'm a planner. So like I plan my workouts for the week. I know what I'm going to do so I can set up. Like I'm not just waking up one morning being like, ah, today I'm going to do this workout. It's like, nope, I'm doing legs Monday. I'm doing, you know, upper body on Tuesday. I'm going to do a yoga sculpt on Wednesday, take Thursday off. Like I have a rhythm and a routine and a plan. And it's the same thing. Like on Mondays, I'm going to write content. On Tuesdays, we're going to do shoot videos. On when, you know, like there's a system and you just find your rhythm. When you find your rhythm, you can just really dig in.
I was, before we jumped on the call, I was going through your Instagram and there's a lot there to take in. And a question came to mind that I don't even know if you've ever really thought about. Do you think people follow you and go to your Instagram account to look for a workout? Or do you think they're already looking at Instagram, you come up in their feed and then they go, oh, I should probably work out?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I know I do see a lot of people like comment like, oh, this inspired me to get moving today or, you know, something like that. So I think it kind of has that. But we have a pretty loyal following that we put out a free 14-day or 30-day challenge and we're always following something. And every week I email you your 7 workouts for the week. Like, here's your workout plan for the week. And people pretty consistently follow that. So people know what to expect from us and they're showing up and they're doing. And every day we're posting the workout of the day and people are usually tackling that workout.
Do you follow, I'm sure you follow other fitness people on Instagram. Does it ever inspire you?
Oh, totally. Yeah. Like I'm learning, you know, I will sometimes when I'm writing a workout, I'll jump on. I have a couple of favorite people that I go to and I just get inspiration. I'm like, I like that move. I'm going to combine it with this move or absolutely. Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons I wanted to have you on is because I saw in a lot of your videos, you do mobility and I'm a runner and I'm what you would call, what's the word? Lazy? not so much lazy. Here's my thing. So every day with all the stuff that I do, I basically give myself an hour to work out, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. That hour is the working out. I don't always incorporate in the stretching, the mobility, especially on run days, especially if it's going to be a longer run. Like I only have a certain amount of time. And I feel like I've never been that mobile of a person. I can't like stretching, all that stuff. So let's talk about what are your tips for runners to stay mobile, to increase their mobility, and when should they do these types of exercises?
Totally. And I mean, like you said, I think that, like everyone always says like, when should I do this? Or what is the best this? And it's like something that you're actually gonna do. So like it's finding what actually you can do and fit into your workout routine. And I will always say and live by this, like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever it is, it's always gonna be better than 0 minutes. Like it's always going to be better than 0 minutes. So for me, I actually have not taken mobility seriously, which I know, like I know this stuff. It's one of those things, like I know this, but I just haven't done it right. I haven't made time for it. I haven't prioritized it until this year specifically. I've made some big commitments with brands and et cetera to film a ton of workout content. And I was like, I can't get injured. Like this is my job. One, this is my livelihood. I've signed up for this. I've committed to this stuff. And like, I need to take care of myself. And so I started taking that a lot more seriously after my second daughter. Like I hired, after I had my second pelvic floor physical therapist, I was like, if I'm going to get back to exercising in 3 months and filming these workout videos, like I got to take care of my pelvic floor. I'm not going to be, you know, jumping around on workout videos, peeing my pants and stuff like this. Like I took this very seriously. And I think that changed my mindset a lot. And I dug in and started teaching myself about mobility and learning it. But for me, fortunately, I have an alarm clock, my daughter, who wakes me up early, and I roll out of bed with her. I take her down to the basement. She has a foam roller. She's one. I give her a foam roller. I take one and she watches mommy and she rolls back and forth on it. But early morning is like my best time. Like it just gets me moving, gets me going, makes me feel better. Roll out. So I'm a foam roller. I like a good lacrosse ball. And sometimes some mornings it's 10 minutes. Some mornings I get 20 minutes in. You know, I'm not saying that everybody needs to do that. But like I said, I consider myself an athlete. And I think the biggest difference, and I think people who run marathons or do any type of strength training, whatever it is at home, I don't think a lot of people consider themselves athletes. They're like, I'm not a professional athlete. And I'm like, listen, you're not a professional athlete, but if you want to train like an athlete, you want to run marathons, you want to do these things, you have to treat yourself like an athlete. And so actually I will say I learned this. My husband is on the side, a professional beach volleyball player. And so kind of watching him and the way he trains for his tournaments and things like that, one of the biggest things I've learned is that if you want to train like an athlete, you have to recover like an athlete. I was not recovering like an athlete. And then, you know, if I get sidelined or injured or something, I'd be like, oh, so bummed. But like, if you want to train like an athlete, you got to recover like one too. And so I think it's a serious part of the training program.
Yeah. I've noticed recently, especially within the last 2 or 3 years, I mean, I'll admit I'm 43. I'll be 44 in June. I could recover easily. And now it's kind of like I'm done running and within a half hour, everything's tightening up. And like, I feel like, all right, well, it's already too late. I should have stretched the minute I was done, but I didn't because I'm doing 10 other things and I'm getting done. So would you recommend like budgeting in the time? Let's say I have that hour to run. Should I say to myself, no, Chris, you only have 50 minutes to run and then you have 10 minutes to stretch it out?
Yeah. Honestly, I think, yes. Like I will say, fit it in wherever you can. If you're going to, whatever feels better for you, like if you're like, I need to just hit the ground running and go and then stretch afterwards. If you can, I think like early morning to wake up your body and right before bed are really great times too. Like while you're putting on Netflix or doing whatever you're doing at night to get ready for bed, like a quick 5 minute stretch routine does wonders, I think, especially before bed, because then you wake up feeling a little bit better too. So I'm a big like early morning before bed, but then I'm not as great. I do a good warm up, but I'm not as great. Like I finish my workout and I'm like, I gotta run and get the kids, or I gotta do something, you know. So I'm not as great at doing it afterwards either. There, that said, I will say there's a difference. So if you're gonna like foam roll specifically before a workout, you should be foam rolling or holding something like a trigger point for 30 seconds. Right? Anything over 30 seconds is going to activate the Golgi tendon in your brain. It's going to tell your muscles to start relaxing. Like, so anything you want to hold more static, you're going to do that after. So post, you can stretch, you can hold a trigger point for up to 2 minutes, but pre-run only 30 seconds.
Here's another thing I've always had problems with, and maybe you can walk me through this. When I do stretch or do mobility things, there's a certain uncomfortableness that comes with it because you're stretching out. How can a person tell the difference between a good uncomfortable and a, oh, that's wrong, uncomfortable?
Right. Totally. It should never be painful. Like, you know, it should never cause pain, but you do have to sit in that uncomfortableness for sure. Especially if you're foam rolling a trigger point, or if you're really, I mean, hip stretches specifically for me, my hips are my tightest spot. So hip stretches can be super uncomfortable, like that couch stretch or wall stretch where you put your leg against the back of a couch or a wall and you like sit up in that half kneeling position. I mean, that's super uncomfortable for me. But you start with like 30 seconds breathing through it and you slowly try and like sit up a little bit more, or, you know, the longer you sit in it. But yeah, that is kind of a hard differentiate, but it should never be painful. I say that and then I laugh because you know, those massage guns, like Right Theraguns or Hypervolt, Hyperisis, they became like this big popular trend. They're available to like everybody now. Yeah. It's funny to me because all these people jumped on the bandwagon of buying them. And I would say probably 10% of people actually use them. It's one of those things, right? Like you have the foam roller that's been sitting in your basement, but how often do you bring it out? Everyone's got these like massage guns at home now. And they're like, yeah, I'm taking my recovery seriously for 2 days. And that thing is over. Like, me and my husband try to use it pretty often on each other, but we definitely make each other cry with it too. So
the first time I ever had one of those used on me was probably, it's been about 3 or 4 years now. I was having shoulder problems, like right around lower shoulder, kind of like trap, like kind of, and it was bothering me a lot. And I went to a chiropractor, and he was like chiropractor slash rehab. And he was like, you know, kind of looking at the problem. And he goes, I just got a new massage gun. Can I try it on you? And I'm like, sure, you know? And like, so I'm a pretty like, you know, stocky guy. And so he's using it on me and it felt really good. And he's like working it in the area. And all of a sudden it goes, and it made this like loud noise. And I like kind of, it didn't hurt, but it just made this noise. And he stopped and he goes, you okay? And I went, yeah. And he's like, I think I hit a rib. And I was like, oh, he goes, did it hurt? And I'm like, no, I'm okay. He goes, all right, I got to learn how to use this better. I was like, right. Yeah, trying it out too. But it just went, and made this loud noise. And it felt great. But, right. And now you see them everywhere. Like I did a Ragnar race where you run trails, run trails. And there was a station where people would do it to you for like 10 minutes. Oh, the first time I think was free. And then after that you had to pay, but there was like always a line to go to it.
Oh yeah. They're great. I mean, they're great. And they become super accessible. Now they make like pocket ones, travel size. I mean, they've like kind of blown up.
But how do you work it on your own like back area?
Yeah, that's why I just love a good lacrosse ball. That's what I do in the morning. I take a lacrosse ball against the wall and I just sit there and like go back and forth. I prefer that better personally, but I mean.
So another thing that I think runners don't pay enough attention to is strengthening, mobility and strengthening of lower back. Like people sleep on lower back a lot. Can we talk about that?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's one of those things that's a common pain and ache for people. It's always lower back pain. It's always my lower back. And it's always, and I think it's a combination of, you know, just not taking care of it, not stretching, not doing mobility. And then the other big thing I would say is when people do get into strength training, it's improper technique or form. And a lot of time it's that slight dip into the low back where your core checks out. So as soon as you get that little dip into the low back, your core instantly checks out. So a lot of times it comes back to core strength. So for women specifically, runners, I think a lot of women, like running is the preferred form of cardio for a lot of women, specifically after having kids, because they can push the kids in a stroller, right? Or a lot of moms love running. It's a good mental release. I mean, I love it. But they get back to running before their core is appropriately healed post kids. And that can easily cause lower back pain. So I'm a huge proponent of strengthening your glutes for back pain, huge proponent of strengthening your glutes, strength training. I love strength training. I just think it carries over into everything. And even with running, like it's just so important. Your glutes, your hips, those are your power generating muscles when you run, right? Those are your power generators. Like the stronger you make them, the more power you can generate with each stride.
I'm about to admit something, and I knew it all along, but like I was just stupid about it. So for years, like I've been working out, like lifting weights since college. So let's say 25 years. so 25 years ago, I started working out. I would rarely do legs. It wasn't my thing. Like I tried, I would do legs maybe once a month. And I would always kind of like say, well, I'm working out, I'm running a lot. And then when I started running seriously, I still wouldn't do legs because I would say running is my legs.
Right. Or they'd be, you're like, oh, my legs are tired from running yesterday, so I'm not going to lift legs.
Right. So probably about 4 or 5 months ago, it was during lockdown, but gyms were back open. I wasn't able to run as much. So I was like, look, I'm just going to, every once a week, I'm going to do a leg day. I just have to. So I started incorporating squats and like the machines and everything. It's a little bit early in the season, but I will say since starting to do all that, I've probably shaved 20 to 30 seconds off my average time of like, now it's only 3 months into it, you know, but my average from last year against my average mile for this year has been insane. And I feel like a lot of it has to do with making my legs stronger. So you can make fun of me for the next couple minutes for that.
No, I'm a huge proponent of strength training. I didn't start it early enough in my life. I think, you know, I thought I had to kill my body in order to get a workout. You had to just be drenched in sweat, totally exhausted. Like I thought that's what it had to be like. And with specifically group fitness, it was always full body, kind of like 10 to 12-ish dumbbells, you know, like never really going super heavy. And then I had kids and I had to like stop working out crazy hard all the time. I couldn't jump and I had to like refigure out how to strength train my body. I came back from each pregnancy stronger because I got so much more into strength training. And I was like, so when I ran that marathon in Haiti there, he was like, you only ran 10 miles before this. Like, are you crazy? And I was like, I know, I hope I can make it. And then, you know, I made it. And he actually, Bryce, who's been running 50 marathons, was like cramped and totally done, gas, like shut down. And I was like, let's go. Like, let's finish it. He was like, how are you possibly doing this? I'm like, strength training. Like, I seriously think like I just came into this so strong that, you know, of course, it's probably not the best strategy for running, but I just think strength training is so important and carries over. And for someone who is maybe struggling with like a PR time or not seeing their time increase, like we all love gratification, right? We live in Amazon world. Like I order something, I want it in 2 days. Like I'm going to start running, I want to get my mile times better, right? Well, sometimes, a lot of times you plateau in running, right? Like, you know, this, you just plateau. Sometimes you even go backwards. Strength training is always a way to see those gains. So maybe your miles are starting to get lower, right? But there's always, you can go from 10 pounds to 12 pounds to 30 pounds to getting in a squat rack and squatting your body weight. Like there's this constant progressive overload that's happening where you see incremental changes and you see yourself getting stronger. And you're, you know, like for me, that's what keeps me going. Like, can I get to the 20 pound dumbbells today? Can I get to the 25s? Like with running, you can't always make those incremental changes.
Mm. Yeah, I agree. One thing I wanted to touch on real quick, back to the video stuff, because it just popped into my head. Mm-hmm. You have the programs where you send them out to people and they can work out, you know, 14 days or whatever. How do you kind of talk to the person who's just like, I've lost all motivation. I could watch all the videos in the world. I can't do it. Or the person who's just like, I can't sit in the middle of my living room floor and work out. Like, how do you motivate that person?
Totally. You know, I think, well, for one, I'd say just try one of my workouts and then you'll see, you'll be so motivated.
That was super duper salesy. And I want you to maybe come put that in some type of video. Cause you even looked at the camera real close. It was so super salesy. I liked it.
it just, the motivation will just overflow onto you. Mm-hmm. No, I think really it's like, people are always like, what's the best, you know, it's going to be what do you love to do? Like, do you, like, if yoga is your thing, if running's your thing, like whatever that is, people, there is no one best form of working out, whatever makes you tick, right? So whatever, and then it's not like tackling the world, but I do think having a plan is so helpful. Just like, you don't have to choose, you show up, I've given you the workout, you got to click and press play. And if you're having a hard time doing that in your living room, I mean, when quarantine, the whole thing started, like everyone was offering these live workouts. So it's like, sign up for a live, right? Or maybe you do join the online gym or whatever it is, if you can't go to a gym, but paying for a class always motivates me. Like, I'm not going to pay, in Minneapolis, it's upwards of $20 for a group fitness class. I'm not going to pay $20 and not show up. Like, you know what I mean? So I think whether it's putting money on it or whether it's getting a girlfriend to go with you, or for me, there's always like that icing on the cake. I call it, like, I hate taxes. Taxes are coming up. So how am I going to make taxes better? I told my husband this Saturday, we're going to pour a cocktail when the kids go down for a nap, and we're going to tackle taxes like on a beautiful Saturday outside with our laptops with a cocktail in hand. Like, there's a way to sweeten it. So for me with workouts, that's, I look forward to like my cold brew I'm going to get after my workout, or, you know, like there's that little like reward that I'm going to work my butt off and then I'm going to earn that coffee. Mm-hmm. So it's whatever, finding kind of whatever makes you tick, you know, and for some people that's posting on Instagram every day that they completed their workout for accountability. If that's you, great, go ahead, tell the whole world you did it, you know, like, awesome, high five yourself. Mm-hmm.
Do you ever follow people on Instagram, and maybe they're not fitness people, but maybe they're like regular people in your life, and you see some of the things they're doing in regards to like working out and eating and stuff, and you want to go, like the trainer Lindsey wants to go, no, but the personal Lindsey's like, maybe I should just mind my own business.
Totally. Totally. Yeah. I mean, that even happens at the gym, right? I'm like, someone's doing something, I'm like, why are you doing that move? I don't know what that's going to do, but I think you're going to hurt yourself in your low back. But just, I just, no, I'm a pretty conflict avoidant person, so I don't say much. But I think in general, like, there's just this, when it comes down to it, like a lot of people end up approaching weight loss specifically as like a weight loss goal. And when it comes down to it, it's 80% nutrition. It's what you're putting in your mouth. You can't outwork a bad diet, right? That's just like the way it is. It's science. You can look it up. And so nutrition is just a huge one. And there's so much stuff out there about nutrition and so many different bandwagons you can jump on, whether it's vegan, vegetarian, paleo, you know, Whole 30 or keto, or there's a million things right out there. And so it's just kind of like, I'm counting macros, not counting, like there's so many things. And I think that's where I really just like go like this with a lot of people, like, you know, deciding for a day that you're only going to eat this or whatever, like it's got to be sustainable. It's just got to be sustainable. Like you can do a certain thing to make habit changes. That's great. But like sustainability, like let's just go back to eating real food. I do nothing. I follow no adherence or diet plan or anything like that. I eat real food. I love real food. I strive for protein and produce at every meal. And I still like pizza and having a beer and all that stuff occasionally too. Like it's all just about everything in moderation.
I want to get your opinion on this because I have asked other people and everyone's got a different opinion on it. How do you feel about cheat days?
I personally don't love them. I mean, I just don't think there's a need. There's just not a need for that. Like I used to, like, trail mix is my thing. Monster trail mix from Target. You know, have you ever seen it? That jar you have Target?
Yeah, we have Target. Where do you think I live? Okay, doesn't everybody have a Target? Does not with someone not have a Target? So.
I don't know. I think so. It's based in Minneapolis. So I always feel like I'm supporting local when I stop there, but I know it's not.
We're in New Jersey. I'm like 3 miles from Princeton. We have Target.
Okay. So Target, Monster Trail Mix, right? The Monster Trail Mix, like there's tons of them. That is my
thing. Does it have like M&Ms in it and stuff? And
it's got M&Ms. It's got like the peanut butter chips, chocolate chips, raisins, peanuts. And I always add almonds. It's basically candy, for sure. It's basically, but I call it, it's trail mix. But I add almonds to it to make it more nutty and, you know. But even with nuts, it's like everyone thought, like, I'm going to eat nuts. It's a great source of protein. It's like, it is, well, when you compare the protein to fat ratio, like, no, it's not, you know. It's not, but I do love trail mix. So that used to be my thing. But, like, I used to only let myself eat it on the weekends. And then on the weekends, I would eat like this whole tub of Monster Trail Mix. And I'd be like, oh, why'd I do that? Right. Like I used to go through this whole thing. And now I just have a handful, maybe two handfuls, maybe three, like every day, even now. It's great. I love it. I get to have my handful of like every night I sit down, I do my late night work. I pop a Spindrift and I have my trail mix. I'm happy. I'm not binging anymore on the weekends on it. Like I feel totally satisfied. Like I just think that there's this mentality that you just like restrict or binge or I don't know. I just think cheat days are just live normally and eat normally.
Yeah. I think a lot of times people get confused with, they'll see someone else do it and they'll think that's the thing I should try. Like,
yeah,
look, The Rock is probably in the greatest shape of any human walking the earth. And he will post, not all the time, but like once every couple months, he'll post his cheat days and his cheat days are insane. And people will go, well, The Rock has a cheat day. And I'll always say, you're not working out like The Rock. The dude is up at 5 a.m. doing an hour of cardio, then lifting weights at night. And like, you're not The Rock. So you can't do that. So I feel like sometimes people go, well, he can do it. So why can't I do it? But you're not doing all the rest. And that's where I think sometimes, and also for me, cheat days have always been like, okay, I'm going to cheat, but my body doesn't know that it's only that day. So the next day it's like, oh, I really want that Monster Trail Mix again. And it doesn't understand that, no, you can't have that anymore.
Totally. And I just, it's like, to that point, like, I think it goes to that, like, people are like, what do you do for pre-workout? What do you take for BCAAs? What do you take? And I'm just like, are you running like multiple marathons? Like, are you really true? Like, unless you are a truly like an athlete, like running multiple, like, you don't need to take BCAAs. You shouldn't be needing pre-workout. Have a cup of coffee. Like, you know, like you don't need all this stuff that like it's put out there, you know, and all like, I showed up to my first marathon and I was like, all these people were like, I had nothing. I had like no belt. I had nothing. Like, I was just like, I'm here to run my 26 miles. There's water stations along the way. Right. I mean, I was not well prepared at mile 18. I was like, I could use one of those gummy gooey pack things that people are eating right now. there is appropriate training methods, right? Yeah. There are times for that type of stuff. But I mean, I always personally think less is more. Like in the end with a lot of it, you know, like BCAAs, you're kind of paying for expensive urine.
Yeah. You know, the one trend that I do hope goes away, it probably won't, but maybe it will, cause there won't be any gyms anymore. Who knows? But the one trend that became huge was every gym had like a smoothie bar.
Yeah.
You'd see people there getting the smoothies after your workout and you don't want to be judgmental, but you're like, I saw you. You weren't really working out to get a smoothie. You were walking on the treadmill for 15 minutes and now you're drinking a 400 calorie smoothie. Like there's no, there's a
workout. And like the smoothie bars, it's like, well, this is a, the smoothie bars have like turned into from like, you know, like a scoop of protein with like some greens and veggies into like mocha chocolate double almond coconut twist, and everyone's like, well, yeah, I want that one. It's yeah. like, well, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
Might as well go get a Frappuccino.
That's the one place, at least none of the gyms that I've ever been to, that's the one place where I feel like the calories should be on there, because people would be like, well, wait a minute, I didn't just burn 700 calories. So I don't know if I should be drinking the 700 calorie drink. That's like the one place that it should be. And I don't, the gyms I've gone to that had them, I don't remember ever seeing the calories on there. I could be wrong. I normally didn't get those things, but I saw people drinking them.
Yeah. And then it all comes back to like that whole thing. Like people are like, well, what's the best thing for weight loss? And it's like, well, ultimately it is calorie deficit. I'm not saying you should be in a calorie deficit all the time, but that's how you lose weight, right? You're calorie deficient. You are consuming less than, you know, your body's output and input. Like it's just, that's how it works.
Since we did touch on it for a minute, let's talk about it. I want to get your opinion. What is working out going to look like for the next 5 years?
Yeah, I know, right? Good question. It's funny because I was actually just on a call with a brand who just did like this, all this research, and they kind of shared their deck with us, and they called it the FMC, the fitness minded consumer. And basically like of the fitness minded consumers, like who's going to go back to the gym, who's not. And obviously there's going to be people that are going back. They do think it'll be a lot less, especially as people have continued to build out their home gyms over quarantine and COVID, you know, whether they've purchased Peloton equipment, Peloton bikes and stuff, or they've gotten squat racks, Rogue, all the stuff like in their gyms and garages. So people have really started building out their home. That said, I think the gym will always, you know, have people who love the gym and need the gym for motivation. Some people just need to go to a gym for motivation. But I think it's definitely changed the mindset. I know a lot of people that have like the new eyeballs I've gotten, I'd say it's been very good for the at-home workout business. So I feel very fortunate in that respect, but the new eyeballs that I've gained, I think the biggest shift, and this is kind of my target audience, is moms, right? So like I made this transition too. And I shouldn't say moms, I should say parenthood. The transition to parenthood really changes your workout mentality, right? Like you can no longer just spend 2 hours at the gym willy-nilly, like hanging out in the sauna and taking a hot shower. Like you got X amount of time to work out. And then, you know, you got kids you got to deal with. So that's when I really switched to working out at home seriously, was when we had kids. So for me, I think that's the shift, and that's who I really target. But people realize how much of a time saver it is to work out at home. Once they can finally get their hands on dumbbells and all stuff, people are like, I can crank out a 30-minute workout at home and I don't have to spend 2 hours at the gym. I think that has like really changed people's mentality of the efficientness and the effectiveness of home workouts. I think a lot of people have found resources now that they like. I think it'll always be a melting pot. I've always thought that the people who have the best fitness, like, mentalities or have the habits that maintain the best fitness schedule, they're a melting pot, right? So maybe they make time for two group fitness classes a week at the gym. They go running 3 days a week, and then they do two home workouts a week, or, you know, people who own Pelotons, all this stuff. Like they're not just doing that. They're also, you know, maybe going to the gym once a week or meeting a girlfriend for a workout or a friend. So I think it's always going to be multifaceted. I think it just got more multifaceted with COVID.
Here's one thing too, that I think is going to change, because I am also a parent, with going to gyms. I don't know if they're going to offer daycare anymore.
Yeah.
At least not for
a long time. And I think that's right. And if it is, it's like smaller and you have to make a reservation, and that causes like, there's more, like I was just talking to someone, I teach class on Friday morning. I just taught class this morning at the gym, and they were like, well, haven't you been back with your kids yet? And I was like, my kids haven't been in the daycare center here. Our daycare center at the gym is open. But there's so many barriers to entry. I'm like, I don't have time to jump on, make reservations, see if this is open. Like, yada, there's so many more barriers to entry that if you're already like slightly resistant to going to the gym, you're not going to take the 7 additional steps to sign up for a class, make sure there's room, adjust your schedule. Like, it's just, there's more barriers to entry.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting. Like, I'm wondering if we're going to see changes like in home sales, like homes with gyms already built in are going to be the big thing. Although I'm just looking for a place now. I can't rent or buy anything. Things literally go in a day.
For equipment?
No, like to work, to live.
Oh, yes.
I'm trying to move.
Yeah, I know.
I'm trying to move. Wild. I looked at an apartment to rent, and while I was looking, it was being rented out from underneath me. Like I went back and I was like, I'll take it. And they're like, we already rented it. And I was like, well, why am I walking through this? So I think like, people are going to be looking at houses or expanding their houses or changing their basements so that they can fit stuff, maybe getting rid of beds, getting rid of bedrooms, just to put gyms in. I think gyms are going to be the new speakeasies in people's houses. Like, you're going to go to so-and-so. Like, I'm going to come to Lindsey's house because I know she's got a bunch of workout equipment.
Totally. Like, I was at the park the other day, and this mom was like, I just got barbell, or I just got a squat rack. You want to come over? It's in my garage. I was like, yes. We changed numbers. I was like, I just made a new friend. I came home. I told my husband, I'm like, I made a friend at the park who's got a squat rack. We got to get to know them. We got to befriend them. Like, yeah.
I heard you guys have a treadmill. Do you have a treadmill here?
Can I come over sometime? You got a big backyard my kids can play in while I run? Like, yeah, like, it's, yeah.
The password is macros.
Seriously, like, I think it's like, I totally think so. Have you transitioned to working out at home?
Okay, so my gym, so this is the weird thing that happened for me. So when everything shut down here, I live maybe 10 minutes over the Pennsylvania border.
Okay.
They reopened before New Jersey did. So my gym actually shut down for good. It was around for like 20 years. It was really depressing. So I ended up joining a gym in Pennsylvania. And I thought to myself, I'm going to join over there, because not that they were more lax with it, but they had a little bit less than what Jersey did. So I thought, if there's going to be another shutdown, Jersey's going to happen first. Pennsylvania's going to happen second. Nope. Pennsylvania shut down for a month in January. New Jersey never shut down. So I have been back at the gym. I went back starting in maybe November, maybe mid-November. I've been working out since. It's very small. There's like, when I've worked out at like the height of working out time, like 5:30 in the afternoon on a weekday, and there's maybe 10 people in there.
Barely. Yeah, you have to wear a mask?
Yes, always have to wear a mask. Yeah. They do have a couple group fitness classes. I don't really take them. But they're pretty good with, like, you know, everyone wipes down their equipment and stuff like that. I do have stuff at home that I bought just in case. Like, I have a 30-pound kettlebell. I have dumbbells. I'm just not the, like, it's funny because as a kid, I had all of my equipment in a basement. Like, I had a full, like, rack in my basement. I went up to 225 pounds. Like, I could go in my basement and work out for 2 hours and not care. But now 15 minutes in my living room and I'm like, I can't do this anymore. I'm bored out of my mind. So I do have stuff, but so accounts like yours help because I can go on and at least it's something different to go. I can go, oh, I should probably try that. So now would be the time that I should do this mobility thing for the running, because if I'm not working out, but I do have a big space in my apartment to like stretch out, that's when I should be doing it.
Totally. Well, I challenge you to do an NML workout. I'll send you a couple of our hardest ones.
I'll tell you what, send me.
I will challenge you. I will send you the hardest workout that has the one that's been named the hardest. It's a 50-minute intense pyramid workout.
In my house?
In your house.
Okay, I'll make you a deal. You send me that. I will record myself doing that video, and then I will post it and tag you in it.
Deal.
Deal. That's a deal. Okay.
Deal.
Before I let you go, before I go die and do this workout. tell everybody where they can find you on your, I loved your website. Tell everybody your website, Instagram, everything.
Yeah. Thank you. My website is nourishmovelove.com. So nourish, move, love. It's just all one word. And that's the same. You can find me on Instagram, same handle, YouTube, same handle, Facebook, same handle. Instagram and YouTube are two, actually, and Pinterest. Pinterest is another primary, but Pinterest and YouTube and Instagram are kind of our primaries. And then obviously the website is where we host all of the workout plans. It's all free. And all of our workout videos on YouTube are also free.
And do you have anything coming up that people should pay attention to?
We're launching a new 30-day workout challenge for April. So we launch new 14-day, 30-day challenges. So you get a daily workout, a workout every day. So it's typically like an arm day, a leg day. Sometimes we do two arm days, two leg days, a couple full body days. And then on your rest days, which there's always two rest days at least built into the calendar, you get mobility workouts. So whether it's like a lower body, upper body, full body mobility. So you have mobility workouts, just 10 minutes to do on your rest days. And if you're a runner, we've been getting so many requests for people who want runner plans. But if you're a runner, I always just say, get in one upper body day, one lower body day, one full body day. So three workouts is your goal. And then you can run on your off days, or you can add running to any of those days that you want to too. But it's all follow along workout videos and you'll get all the motivation you need.
Okay. I'll make you a deal. If I successfully do this video, I'll come to Minnesota and you have to run with me.
Oh, deal. How far are we going to run?
well, how far do you think you could run now?
You know, the mo let's see, I did 5 miles the other day. That's kind of my max right now. It's like a good 5 mile run. But I'm always up for a challenge. Actually, you know what? If you come to Minnesota, you know what we're gonna do? We'll
What?
do the Murph. We'll do the Murph.
I've done a
I
Murph.
love.
All right, I've done a Murph, but I didn't do the weighted vest Murph.
Yeah, same. Not the weighted vest. I don't have a weighted vest. So it's just the run a mile. It's
Okay.
300 squats, 200
Yeah.
push-ups, 100 pull-ups. I get to use a band, and then you run another mile.
Yeah. Also, mine was a little bit, I don't want to call it like a modified Murph, but the problem was I had to do it on playground equipment. So the pull-up bar was like not that great. Like it
Yeah,
was literally a
totally.
bar where I like could touch the ground while I was doing it. So I had to hang. It was like, so it wasn't like I would do a legit Murph if I could find the correct equipment outside. But I'll tell you what,
Totally.
that last mile was awful.
Yeah, it's way harder than you think, but I love it. It's a good challenge. It's a
Yeah.
good gut check.
I do eventually want to take the show on the road. And when my co-host comes on, Gina's supposed to be my co-host. She was not here today because she's running a marathon. And she's running an actual, like, it's social distance marathon, and it's in
Yeah.
Virginia, and you can start anytime you want. And she was going to be here for the interview, except she realized it was more advantageous to drive today than it was tomorrow. So she ended up having to leave early. So maybe I will drag her to Minnesota and
There
we'll
you
all
go.
do the workout.
You guys come to Minnesota, we'll run a marathon and we'll do the Murph.
Yes, just nice
All
weather.
in one weekend.
Yeah, and then we'll make friends with that lady with the squat rack.
Right? Exactly. She'll have us over and we can squat out some reps.
Yeah, let's also plan it when you do that outside drinks thing, because that would probably be more fun.
Yeah. I mean, you come to Minnesota in the summer, it's beautiful.
And I'll bring you trail mix.
And trail, I gotta pick up a tub of that monster stuff from a Target if you have one.
I do. We just got one.
Good.
Lindsay, thanks so much for talking.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me.
And that's going to bring another episode of We Run This to a close. Gina and I want to thank our guest and thank everyone that's listening out there.
If you love the show, please be sure to share it with your friends and leave a review on iTunes.
If you want to follow the show on social, check us out on Instagram and Twitter at WeRunThis_pod. That's WeRunThis_pod.
Thanks for listening, and we'll see you out on the road.